ashes of fear ruin. There is a peace that settles around us. It is a love that sets our hearts ablaze. There is a light that burns in the darkness. Is there is a peace that settles around us. It is a love that sets our hearts ablaze. Father, we're on our knees with every heartbeat awake, when you lift us off.
Good morning. Welcome to church. We're so glad you guys are here. We did it. We did kids camp. It was so great. It was our best kids camp yet. And we had our family fun day on the Friday, and it was our best family fun day yet. And then we had youth on Friday, and it was our best youth yet. It was so good. God was so faithful, and he showed up, and it was so great. So we want to show you guys a couple pictures from our kids camp. It was so good. We had so many fun activities and so many people that was there that have never been there before, and it was so good. So we just want to thank you guys for everything that you did to make Kids Camp happen. Together, we were able to make it so amazing and so great. No matter if you just gave some supplies or if you've been praying or if you sent your kids or if you guys came, together, we were able to make it so awesome, and we're so thankful for your guys' generous hearts. So I have a verse to encourage you with in Corinthians, because we can't get enough of Corinthians. So It says, it's not important who does the planting or who does the watering. What's important is that God makes the seed grow. The one who plants and the one who waters work together with the same purpose, and both will be rewarded for their own hard work, for we are both God's workers. So we are so thankful that you guys are willing to just be a part of Kids Camp in whatever way, and God will bless no matter how small or big. We needed everything, and we're so thankful that you guys work together for these great plans that God has. So I'm going to pray. God, thank you so much for showing up. Thank you for all that you did in Kids Camp and in the lives, and thank you for bringing such generous people. We pray that we will hear your voice and that we will worship you with our full hearts. In your name we pray. Amen.
Christ is my firm foundation.
I see.
gave your life for mine. Nailed to the cross, you crucified all my sin and shame. It was washed by your mercy. You are the treasure I find, my reason for living. So let my life become an offering to the one who is worthy. All praise to the Lord Most High. All praise to the one who saved my life. All praise to Jesus Christ, my King.
Praise and glory. We thank you that you are here with us, you love us, and that you choose us. In Jesus' name, amen. Kids, you can head off to kids' church if you want. There's preschool upstairs. Well, everything's upstairs. If you head out the back, then the leaders will help you find where you need to go. Thank you. Well, good morning. We are continuing on in 1st and 2nd Corinthians. Well, we've moved on to 2nd Corinthians. There's a lot to cover in these two chapters. And if you're getting sick of listening about 1st and 2nd Corinthians, I have good news for you. Well, one is that we're almost done with 2nd Corinthians. But two is that there are 64 more books in the Bible that you can feel free to read at home. So then you won't get bored with whatever we're talking about here, right? I think it's been a great series. It's been really exciting to just read these letters from Paul and to know how they can relate to our lives right now. And I wanted to talk today about promises. Promises. If you have children or have ever been around children, have you ever had this experience where they're like, oh, can we go to the park? And you're like, we'll see, right? Like maybe next week or maybe tomorrow. And then the next morning, they're like standing at your bed staring at you, right? They've come for their promise. They're like, you said, we're going to go to the park. It's time to go to the park today. You promised. I'm like, I don't think I promised. Oh, my kids will be like, you promised. And here's one thing I've learned quickly in parenting is I don't promise. This is my promise to you. I don't make promises because I know how easy they are to break. And especially my kids, they'll all be like, oh, let's go to the park. We're going to go to the park. And I'm kind of like, ugh, that seems like such a lot of work. I don't know. We'll see, I say. We'll see. I don't promise. I can confidently tell you. I'm like, can you imagine? Your kids are like, can we go to the park? You're like, oh, I promise. I promise. No matter what, I'll take you tomorrow. No way. No way, man. You could have gotten the flu the night before and be dead in your bed. And they'd be like, you promised. And then you couldn't be like, oh, no, I didn't promise. See? So you just, I know that I get out of breaking promises because I don't make them. And perhaps that's the same for you. It seems a lot safer to just not make a promise because then you don't have to worry about breaking your promise. So anytime my kids are like, you promised, I'm like, I am confident. I did not promise. I remember as a kid when my parents said, we'll see. That was the worst. Ugh, well, we'll see just means no. I remember it. And now as a parent, I'll be like, we'll see. Like, we'll see. They're just like, we'll see does kind of mean no. We'll see is my way out. We'll see is the way that I don't have to make promises. So then when they come and say you promise, I can be like, I said we'll see. We're seeing now? Nope. It's not going to happen. So we just avoid making promises. Anybody else? It's just safer to not make promises. I'm not alone in that. Because a promise feels like a big deal. If you say, I promise, there's something in us, we're like, this is a big deal. Even as a kid, I remember in, like, pinky promises. Right? And my kids will try to get me that way. So I don't say I'll promise, but they'll be like, I'll be like, maybe. And then they'll be like, like, no, I do not do that. That is just as bad. It's very dangerous. We do not promise. No pinky promises. But here's the thing about God. Well, there was somebody, I don't know his name, I couldn't find out. Well, his last name was Stott. No, Scott. But I couldn't find out his first name. So this guy, whose last name is Scott, who's much more intelligent than I am and has apparently more time on his hands, he found out that there are 7,487 promises throughout the Bible that are made from God to mankind. 7,487 promises. That is a lot more promises than I've ever made. And he keeps his promises. Here are some of the promises. God promises. Psalm 108:13 says, God will give you victory. He promises in Isaiah 43, verses 1 and 2, that he's always with you. In Deuteronomy 32:34, that his ways are good. In Psalm 18, verses 2 to 3, that he will always be a safe place for you. In Exodus 14:14, that he will fight for you and protect you. In Psalm 37, verse 4, that he cares about what you care about. In Proverbs 8:35, he promises you a full life. There's so many promises throughout Scripture. Promises that he will be near to you, that he will give you a hope and a future. He promises to love you and strengthen you. 7,487 promises specifically made from God to you. So we're picking up in 2 Corinthians 1, verses 20 to 22. It says, for all of God's promises, all 7,487 of them have been fulfilled in Christ with a resounding yes. And through Christ, our amen, which means yes, ascends to God for his glory. It is God who enables us, along with you, to stand firm for Christ. He's commissioned us, and he's identified us as his own by placing the Holy Spirit in our hearts as the first installment that guarantees everything he has promised. God's promises are fulfilled in Jesus Christ, and they're written on our hearts as the first installment, the first measure of his promise and the work that Jesus did on the cross so that you can have all of those promises from God. Amen. Amen doesn't mean let's eat, just in case. Just in case you weren't sure, right? That's usually what happens. Amen. Let's eat. Let's do this thing. Nope. Amen means so be it. Means yes, as it should be. Whatever you said, I'm in agreement. Yes. And Jesus is the yes that fulfills all of the promises that God made all through the Old Testament, all the promises to mankind from then and now forever. The promises are fulfilled because of Jesus Christ. He came and he died, and what he accomplished on the cross fulfilled every single promise that God made. Jesus' death and resurrection is the so be it. It's the yes. It's the amen yes. All of these promises, and I wanted to talk about a covenant because they kind of go hand in hand, promises and covenant, but there is a difference. And the main difference between a covenant and a promise is that in a covenant, both parties have clear obligations and responsibilities. In a promise, we observe that the active role is undertaken by one party while the other remains passive. For example, if I promise to go to the park, what do my kids have to do? Nothing. They just show up and get all the goods. They get to go to the park. In a covenant, it means that both people sacrifice. Both people are laying down their lives and doing something to commit to this relationship. I think about this in terms of marriage. And when we do our vows and we're like, I promise to do this thing and I promise to whatever. Why don't I know vows? I literally marry people and I can't pull them out of my head right now. Oh well, write your own if you come to me. But we make these promises, and marriage needs to be more like a covenant, where both people are committed to doing things for the other for the benefit of the relationship. We picked this song for our wedding, Jordan and I. Let's be real. I picked this song, and we played it at our wedding. That's what happened. And I heard this song on an Old Navy commercial. Yes. It's written by Ingrid Michaelson. It's called The Way I Am. And here are the lyrics from our wedding. It says, if you were falling, then I would catch you. If you need a light, I'll find a match. If you are chilly, here, take my sweater. If your head is aching, I'll make it better. I'll buy you Rogaine when you start losing all your hair. And sew on patches to all you tear. Now, I don't want to say this is like foreshadowing or anything, or that it brought anything into existence, okay? Like, we really laughed at that. Oh, I'll buy you Rogaine when you start losing on your hair. Isn't that funny and cute? 15 years later, he's so bald that when my daughter didn't understand what the word radiant meant, Grammy's explaining it to her, and she's like, oh, like Dad's head? I guess so. So now she understands the word radiant. But even in these lyrics for this song, it could totally be one-sided. It's promises, right? It's promises that one person is going to do one thing. But it becomes covenant when two people engage in a relationship. And two people say, I'm going to bring this, and I'm going to lay down this for the betterment of our relationship. It wouldn't work well if it was just promises. One person can't do everything and then have the other person be passive. But the covenant means both people are committed to upholding their own part of the promise that's required for the relationship to work. So 2 Corinthians, Paul is writing to this church in Corinth about the old and the new covenant. So there's an old covenant, aka Old Testament, and a new covenant that we read about in the New Testament. Old covenant and new covenant. And Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 7, he says, "The old way, with laws etched in stone, led to death. Though it began with such glory that the people of Israel could not bear to look at Moses' face. For his face shone with the glory of God, even though the brightness was already fading away." Moses' face shone with the glory of God. It was radiant. That's where the word came from. In case you need the visual. So I think we can't talk about the old covenant and the new covenant until we like talk about the old covenant. So we're going to dig into history and we're going to look all the way back in Exodus to the story where Moses goes up into the mountain, meets with God, and gets the old covenant on behalf of the people. And this is what happens. The Israelites have been rescued from Egypt. They're wandering in the desert. They're like, now what? Everybody's cranky. It would be like taking 25-year-olds hiking after 20 minutes. Right? You can picture it. Everyone's cranky. No one wants to be there. Someone's wandering off. You don't have enough food or snacks. It's hot. My legs are tired. Okay, so Moses is dealing with all of these people by the thousands. And he goes up to the mountain in Exodus 19. Moses climbed the mountain to appear before God. And the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "Give these instructions to the family of Jacob. Announce it to the descendants of Israel. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians. You know how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you will obey me and keep my covenant, you will be my own special treasure from among all the peoples on earth. For all the earth belongs to me. And you will be my kingdom of priests, my holy nation. This is the message you must give to the people of Israel." So Moses returned from the mountain and called together the elders of the people and told them everything the Lord had commanded him. And all the people responded together, "We will do everything the Lord has commanded." So Moses brought the people's answer back to the Lord. So this is covenant. God says, "This is what I'm going to do for you, and this is my promise to you. You will be my chosen people." And the people respond, "Yes and amen." And they say, "Yes, we're going to do this. Yes, we will do everything you've commanded." So Moses goes back up the mountain to tell God. Side note, while he's up there, everything goes crazy, and they don't do anything God commanded, and they're absolutely insane. It's literally like the toddlers on the mountain, okay? So Moses goes back up the mountain. The people were, and read in 33, verses 18. Oh, no, wait, I skipped ahead. I'm sorry. My notes are really bad today. It messed me up for a service, too. I should have fixed it. Okay, so the people were just afraid of what happens. Moses goes up and tells God, the people are like, "Yes, we will do this thing." And so God says, "I will come and speak to the people." So Moses comes down the mountain, and the voice of God is heard, and the people are like, "Ooh, no, thanks. This is too scary. It's too much for us. We don't want to hear the voice of God. Can you just talk to him and then tell us what he said?" And so Moses is like, okay, so back up the mountain he goes. Which, I mean, I haven't been to Mount Sinai, but I assume it's bigger than the hill at the regional park. And this is a lot of hiking that has happened already. So Moses goes back up the mountain and he gets all these instructions from God. And he's given the Ten Commandments, and he's given instructions that the people need to follow in order to be a part of covenant with God. And the rules that exist, that are the instruction that's given from God, is for their cleanliness and their health and their safety. It's to set parameters and rules around a people that have never governed themselves. Some of the rules: no other gods before God. That he is number one, that they would have no idols, that they wouldn't use God's name in vain, that they would keep the Sabbath holy, that they would honor their father and mother, that they wouldn't murder, and they wouldn't commit adultery, and they wouldn't steal, and they wouldn't lie, and they wouldn't covet. So God lays out all of these ways to live. This is what it means to be part of his covenant, to belong to God, to participate in covenant relationship around cleanliness and sacrifice, around the building of the temple and the way that they were to wear their clothes and how they were to react and interact with God and with other people. And after the people heard all of this new covenant, then they committed to obey the Lord. And so Moses goes up on the mountain. He's there for 40 days and 40 nights where God is giving him all of this information. And then Moses says, "Can you show yourself to me so that when I go back there, everyone will know I have seen you And they'll know that this came from God. Because it'd be really easy for Moses to go up on the mountain, come back after 40 days, and everybody be like, oh, sure. Like, what were you doing for 40 days? He wanted to have evidence that he had been with God and the people would know and would see. So Exodus 33:18, Moses says, show me your glorious presence. And the Lord replied, I will make all my goodness pass before you. And I will call out my name, Yahweh, before you, for I will show mercy to anyone I choose, and I will show compassion to anyone I choose. But you may not look directly at my face, for no one may see me and live. And the Lord continued, look, stand near me on this rock. As my glorious presence passes by, I will hide you in the crevice of the rock and cover you with my hand until I've passed by. Then I will remove my hand and let you see me from behind, but my face will not be seen. See, God is too big, too perfect, too holy, too powerful for Moses to gaze at him directly. And so he says, you can see me, see my presence, but I'm going to hide you in this rock. I'm going to cover you with my hand. And as I walk past, I'll remove my hand and you can see my back, because otherwise there's no way you can live. So Moses, it has this experience with God. He represents the people. He accepts the new covenant. They come into covenant with God, and this is the relationship. And so then Moses returns back down the mountain. In Exodus 34, 29 to 35, it says, Moses came down Mount Sinai carrying the two stone tablets. It's inscribed with the terms of the covenant. Have you ever seen like those really old movies? He's like, his hair is long and flowing behind him. As he walks down, he's carrying these stone tablets. And I think, like, in our Bible, these instructions from God are, like, 5 chapters long. So it always makes me wonder, like, how did he get those stone tablets down? Like, he's like, right? I'm not so sure it would be this glorious, like, carrying 2 bags of sugar down the mountain or something. I'm not sure how it happened. But he's carrying the stone tablets. They're inscribed with the terms of the covenant. But Moses wasn't aware that his face had become radiant because he had spoken to the Lord. So when Aaron and the people of Israel saw the radiance of Moses' face, they were too afraid to come near him. But Moses called out to them and asked Aaron and all the leaders of the community to come over, and he talked with them. Then all the people of Israel approached him, and Moses gave them all the instructions the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. When Moses finished speaking with them, he covered his face with a veil. But whenever he went into the tent of meeting to speak with the Lord, he'd remove the veil until he came out again. Then he would give the people whatever instructions the Lord had given him. And the people of Israel would see the radiant glow of his face. So he would put the veil over his face until he returned to speak with the Lord. It seems so crazy. Moses had to cover his face with a veil. It was because his experience with the old covenant, his experience with God, meant that other people were too afraid and they couldn't look at him. They couldn't see God through him. It was too much for them. And so he covered his face with a veil so that they weren't afraid, so they didn't get to see the glorious countenance of the Lord. They didn't get to see it. Even secondhand, they couldn't see God in the old covenant, in the old way. So if this is the old covenant, the old covenant where God set rules and boundaries and all of these things in place for people to follow, well, we also have a new covenant. And 2 Corinthians tells us about this new covenant. In 2 Corinthians 3, verses 8 and 9, shouldn't we expect far greater glory under the new way now that the Holy Spirit is giving life? If the old way, which brings condemnation, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new way, which makes us right with God? If this old covenant was so glorious, people couldn't even look at Moses' face because his covenant with God is the thing that marked him and changed him. And that was good, even though it wasn't the best. Then how much better is the new way? In Jeremiah 31, verses 31 to 34, it's an Old Testament prophecy, and this is God's plan and promise for the people. It says, the day is coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah. And this covenant will not be like the one I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and brought them out of the land of Egypt. They broke that covenant, though I loved them as a husband loves his wife, says the Lord. But this is the new covenant I will make with the people of Israel after those days. I will put my instructions deep within them, and I will write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. And they will not need to teach their neighbors, nor will they need to teach their relatives, saying, you should know the Lord. For everyone from the least to the greatest will know me already, says the Lord. And I will forgive their wickedness, and I will never again remember their sins. The New Testament means that the Holy Spirit is written on your heart. That the old rules and the old covenant and the old way that things were is replaced because Jesus shed his blood on the cross. And the new covenant is fulfilled through Jesus Christ. And that means we don't need to hide our faces, that people see Jesus in and through you, that you have access to the throne room of the King of Kings, that Jesus makes a way for freedom and for hope and for a future, that we aren't tied down and held back by rules and restrictions that we can never hope to accomplish perfection. In 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 25, we see what is the new covenant. Paul says, I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and gave thanks to God for it, that he broke it in pieces and said, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. His blood and his sacrifice is the amen to the promise and the covenant of God. It says, do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you're announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. This is the new covenant. Jesus said it himself, that his sacrifice is the thing that replaces all of the old covenant. He's fulfilled it all. He came as the yes and amen to the promises of God, and it's fulfilled in his life on earth, his death on the cross, and his resurrection. It is the yes indeed to what God always wanted for his people. Hebrews 8, verses 1 to 10 says, here's the main point. You know, under the old covenant, there were all these rules around high priests and who they are and what they did. It says, we have a high priest who sat down in the place of honor beside the throne of the majestic God in heaven. There he ministers in the heavenly tabernacle, the true place of worship that was built by the Lord and not by human hands. And since every high priest is required to offer gifts and sacrifices, our high priest must make an offering too. If he were here on earth, he would not even be a priest, since there already are priests who offer the gifts required by the law. They serve in a system of worship that's only a copy, a shadow of the real one in heaven. For when Moses was getting ready to build the tabernacle, God gave him this warning. Be sure that you make everything according to the pattern I've shown you here on the mountain. But now Jesus, our high priest, has been given a ministry that is far superior to the old priesthood. For he is the one who mediates for us a far better covenant with God based on better promises. The first covenant had been faultless. If the first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no need for a second covenant to replace it. But when God found fault with the people, he said, the day is coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah. This covenant will not be like the one I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and led them out of the land of Egypt. They did not remain faithful to my covenant, so I turned my back on them, says the Lord. But this is the new covenant I will make with the people of Israel on that day, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds, and I will write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. When God speaks of a new covenant, it means he has made the first one obsolete. It's now out of date and will soon disappear. The new covenant is no longer brought to fulfillment by obeying the laws and rules that God gave to Moses and the people. It doesn't mean that you just like don't follow. They're pretty good rules, right? Don't murder. That seems like a good one we should probably hold on to. They're good rules, but it's not those rules and regulations that define your relationship with God anymore. The new covenant is summed up in this from the mouth of Jesus. When all the rulers and the religious leaders were like, okay, we're going to trap Jesus and we want to find out what is the most important thing that we should do in order to have eternal life. And so they say, "Teacher, what is the most important commandment in the law of Moses?" Jesus replied, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself." The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. Jesus fulfilled the old covenant. He fulfilled what was. It wasn't the perfect system God wanted, and he needed to send his son to fulfill that law, to fulfill the covenant, to create a new covenant that allows us access to God, a relationship with Jesus, and the Holy Spirit written on your heart so that everybody knows who he is. There are a lot of things that we get to anticipate and expect from the new covenant. In 2 Corinthians, just at the end, we're going to read 2 Corinthians 3, verses 10 to 18. These are promises that we have, expectations that we get, things from the new covenant. This is the promise for us. It says, "In fact, that first glory was not glorious at all compared with the overwhelming glory of the new way. So if the old way, which has been replaced, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new, which remains forever?" The old way, the glorious shining of God on Moses, it was temporary. And he had to cover it with a veil because the people couldn't handle it. But the new way is even more glorious. The new covenant is far more glorious than even that experience with the old covenant. And it means that everyone can have relationship with God. Everyone can come to God. And that when he shines on you, it changes your life. And you look different. 2 Corinthians 3:12 says, "Since this new way gives us such confidence, we can be very bold." The old covenant was scary. The Israelites didn't want anything to do with it. It was too much. It was too scary. But the new covenant gives us confidence so that we can be bold, that we can approach God, that we can be bold about what has happened in our lives and the changes and the things that God asks of us. We have a boldness that didn't exist before, a confidence in who we are and who we've been called to be. In 2 Corinthians 3, verses 13 to 16, it talks about how the veil is pulled over our eyes, right? Remember, Moses had to have the veil because the people couldn't handle it. So we're not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so the people of Israel would not see the glory, even though it was destined to fade away. But the people's minds were hardened, and to this day, whenever the old covenant is being read, the same veil covers their minds so they cannot understand the truth. And this veil can be removed only by believing in Christ. Yes, even today, when they read Moses' writings, their hearts are covered with that veil, and they do not understand. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. That veil represents the old covenant, and the new covenant means there is no veil. It doesn't need to be there anymore. 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, "For the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom." The new covenant gives freedom. You're not trapped under a system of legalism and rules and laws to try to create a perfect life that can get you to God. That's not how it works. The new covenant gives you the freedom to accept just the gift of Jesus as a sacrifice. That's the promise of the new covenant. And then verse 18 has two. It says, "So all of us have had that veil removed. All of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord." That's one of the things. When we have the new covenant, we get to see the glory of the Lord and reflect that to the people around us. We get to be radiant. And so the glory of the Lord is reflected to the people around us. And the second thing is that the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him as we're changed into his glorious image. The new covenant challenges us, encourages us, and allows us to become more and more like Jesus. That's what we're supposed to be doing. We're meant to see and reflect the glory of God and then to become more and more like Jesus. The old covenant with Moses served its purpose. And the new covenant fulfills it to the point that Jesus has given us freedom. And it's so much more glorious. And we have confidence and boldness. And we can see and reflect the glory of God. And we can become more and more like Jesus so that we can follow the two most important commandments: to love God and to love the people around us. That's what we're called to do. In Hebrews 13, verses 20 to 21, it says, "Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, and ratified an eternal covenant with his blood, may he equip you with all you need for doing his will. May he produce in you through the power of Jesus Christ every good thing that is pleasing to him. All glory to him forever and ever. Amen." This new covenant fulfills everything. This new covenant is what gives you access to those promises of God fulfilled through Jesus Christ, so that you can see and reflect the glory of God to the people around you. So God, we thank you for the gift of your son, Jesus. We thank you that he made a way, that he changed everything. We thank you that you have given us a hope and a future. We thank you that you've made a way with a new covenant and that you fulfill all of your promises to us. So God, we just hold tight to those promises. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you that you're with us, that you walk beside us, that you cheer for us, that you love us and choose us. So we thank you that you're with us. We love you and we just want to continue to worship you.
Trying so hard to see it, took me so long to believe it, and you choose someone like me to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it, you give what we don't deserve, and you take the broken raise them to glory. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Jesus has given me. When I open up my mouth, miracles start breaking out. I have the authority Jesus has given me. When I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority Jesus has given me. Every battle you've won, I am who you say I am. Crown me with confidence, I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated by the power of your name. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated with the one who has conquered it all.
Lord, thank you that you define who we are, that you say who we are. It's not by our mistakes, our sins, or our achievements. We are just who you say you are. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, I have a few announcements for the fall. So very exciting, but kind of sad that summer is over. But we have some exciting things happening in the fall. The first one is youth. Our next youth day is September 8th. The next youth day is September 8th, so there's nothing this week. You can enjoy the last week of summer, and then we'll be back up on the 8th. It's for grades 7 to 12, 7 to 9. It's a brand new game that Carson and I invented last night, so it's going to be great. It's a series of challenges that you guys will do, and then you'll work together, and you'll keep doing all these mini challenges. It's going to be super fun. And the next thing in the fall we have is our Kids Relate group starting up. This is year 5 already of us doing Kids Relate Group. It's for if you're going into grades 3 to 6, we learn about the Bible. This year we're going through the New Testament, so each day will be a book or so, and we'll answer questions and we'll learn. If you are interested in helping with youth or Kids Relate Group in the fall, definitely come talk to me. We would love to have you help out and help serve, and there's lots to do, and there's lots of kids, so it's lots of fun. Carpet squares. You guys have been so generous. We have so many carpets already, and we only need 307 more. So if you're interested, when you're giving, you can just mark it that it's 4 carpets. They're $15 a square, and yeah, we're close to getting them done. So we are so thankful that you guys are generous and that you're faithful with what God calls you to do. So if you want to give to the mission, to anything that we do here at the church, there's so many ways you can give. You can put an envelope in the box, or if you need help, Nathan and Anna can help you, or we even have e-transfer, which is what I do, and it's way easier. So I'm going to pray. Lord, thank you that you are good. Thank you that you take whatever we are able to give, and you do so much with that. We pray that we'll be faithful and that we'll clearly hear your voice and what to do. And that, yeah, in our last song, that we'll just feel you and hear something from you. In your name, amen. Oh, and there's cup.
every